Aidee completed her medical education in 1997 at the University of Ghana Medical School, a top-notch medical school. Aidee graduated with a student clinicians, where she graduated with honors and received the Albert Paracelsus Award in ophthalmology. She completed her internal medicine residency training at Good Samaritan Hospital, Incorporated, affiliated with John Hopkins University School of Medicine in Baltimore, Maryland, in 2002. In 2004, she completed fellowship training in infectious disease in a combined training program at Creighton University Medical Center and University of Nebraska Medical Center and the Veterans Administration Hospital in Omaha, Nebraska. During this period, she authored several books. She is a board-certified infectious disease specialist and a fellow of the Infectious Disease Society of America and the American College of Physicians. In 2012, when she became the CEO and medical director of Global Infectious Disease Services, she worked at Mercy Medical Center in Sioux City, Iowa, providing invaluable infectious disease services and consultation to the two local hospitals and physicians in the Siouxland area. During this time, she completed a master's in business administration with a focus on healthcare services administration, graduating in 2013. She did this with the hopes of building a state-of-the-art health center in Africa and starting a private practice. She has authored two books, articles in leading medical journals, book chapters, as well as several internet publications. She is an adjunct professor of medicine at the North Nebraska Medical Center. She's married to Dr. Richard Aidee. They have three sons. She enjoys Bible study, Bible teaching, cooking, sewing, and making jewelry. Thank you, and please, Dr. Aidee.
Thank you, Judy, for the kind introduction. And I want to thank all of you for coming. Wow, we've had a good turnout today. There are a lot of you here. I'm glad that you're here. Without you, if you don't show up and you don't show up and you don't show up, there'll be no conference. So you are really the conference. And there's been an icebreaker already from the one who introduced the program, so I don't have any jokes to share. So we'll just launch into hepatitis C. And today, why am I even discussing hepatitis C at this time? Actually, my husband asked me, why are you going to talk about hep C? What is the relevance to your infectious disease symposium? And I thought it was a good question. So I'll tell you why we're discussing hepatitis C. I've been in this community for 11 years, and before I came, I was told that there were hepatitis C patients here and I needed to treat them. So as part of my fellowship, I did about 6 weeks of hepatitis C training, working with hepatologists so that when I come here, I'll be ready. So I've been treating hepatitis C for a good 11 years. And in the hepatitis C world, this is an extremely exciting time. Actually, I will quote someone from the New England Journal of Medicine. He said, the future is here. We're at a major crossroads or a major turnaround in the way hepatitis C was treated. When I came to Sioux City, or actually when I was in medical school and in residency, if somebody had hepatitis C, their chances of cure was only 10%. They only got interferon every day, and this was associated with bodily aches, neutropenia. A lot of people stopped treatment. And then came pegylated interferon. And this one, they were given three times a week. That was when I was still treating hep C 11 years ago. And it was replete with side effects. I mean, I had one patient who had so much, she got so depressed. She was a single mother living with her three children. She was going to kill all of them. She just rushed to the hospital, came to see me and said, I can't do this anymore. She was admitted to the psychiatric unit. So these were the problems we're having with hepatitis C. And now, what do we have? We have single dose treatments that you can take by mouth. The catch 20 is some of them cost up to $80,000 for the 12-week course. So of course, you have to now start to ration. Who is going to get treatment? And there's a lot of politics surrounding hepatitis C. So that is why I thought it's extremely important that you should know about it. So once I told my husband this, he said, okay, I think that maybe that's a good thing to talk about. Otherwise, don't tell these people about hep C. They don't need to know about it. And the other reason why I think you need to know about hepatitis C is that in 2012, the Centers for Disease Control released guidelines for testing patients between the age of 45 to 65. And again, that's a little catch-20. As you read the guidelines, they give all the reasons why patients should be treated, but then they add that, okay, there are all these direct-acting agents coming out, and you can do oral treatment, and so that is why everybody should be tested. I don't know if they should have put that in there, because to a business person, it almost sounds like a conflict of interest. It's like you're telling us to test everybody so we can get more people on these $80,000 drugs, but I don't think that was the intent. I think it's truly to get people to use these life-changing meds. So this is the cover issue of Bloomberg Business Week. This was from June, and as you can see, they were going to discuss the hepatitis C drugs, and I think almost every business journal and almost every medical journal has discussed hepatitis C treatment. And this is that headline, treatment for saving a life. One pill daily for 12 weeks, costing $94,500? Really? Is that a cost to save a life? We have patients with diabetes. We have patients with all sorts of medical problems. Should the state spend this much money treating a patient? So I want you to pay attention. The objectives of my lecture are threefold. Explain transmission so that you as a healthcare provider can advise people how to stop it. Talk about the current diagnostic tools, because I do have patients come in and sometimes, I mean, I like doing the workup, but if you can do some of it before the patients come to see us, it will be beneficial to the patients and it will save time. And also explain the rationale for the current treatment modalities for hepatitis C. So I'll kind of go back. Can you all see the slide? Is it too bright? Do you want the front to be darker? You're fine? Okay. All right, so I'll start from the back and then we'll kind of work towards the beginning. So this is what hepatitis C treatment is trying to prevent. This, cirrhosis. Can you all say cirrhosis? Cirrhosis of the liver. That's what we're trying to prevent. And in so doing, hepatitis C treatment tries to achieve one thing. It's called SVR, sustained viral response. The whole point of treatment is to get rid of the virus. The 95,000 is supposed to get rid of the virus and stop the progression to cirrhosis. So if the treatment is able to achieve that, then it has been successful. It was this SVR, or sustained viral response, that could not be achieved with all those other pegylated interferons, which led them to their 10%, 50%, and 60% rates. But these newer medications are able to achieve that. So what happens when somebody has acute, gets infected with hepatitis C? Initially, they have this acute infection. And unlike hepatitis A and B, where when somebody gets infection, they're really, really sick. Their liver enzymes are like 3,000 and 6,000. They're vomiting. I mean, if somebody gets acute hepatitis A, they're deathly ill. Hepatitis C, acute infection, sometimes they're ill, but not so ill. It happens within 6 weeks of getting infected. A lot of people, in essence, don't even know that they have hepatitis C. In fact, most people who have hepatitis C don't know, and that's why you're here, so that if you learn about it, you can start testing your patients. Now, with chronic hepatitis B, which is more common in developed countries, one out of every 10 patients who gets hepatitis B will go on to develop a chronic infection. However, with hepatitis C, it's different. Rather, 9 out of 10 would rather go on to develop a chronic infection. So only 10% of people are lucky enough to clear the virus themselves. So I do have patients, that's why I'm saying you should listen to how the testing goes, because of course it will reduce my referrals, but it's okay, it will help the patients. If somebody has a positive antibody test, The next thing you should do is to check if they have virus in their blood. If they don't have virus, they're probably one of the 10% of people who cleared it. So they do not need to be treated. So positive antibody is not equal to active infection because 10% of people will clear the virus on their own. And the numbers vary depending on the individual themselves, but so 55 to 85% of people will go on to develop chronic hepatitis C. 15 to 45% will get spontaneous resolution. I use 10 and 90 because it's easy to remember. And of those who develop chronic hepatitis C, the factors are unclear as to why some progress to cirrhosis and some don't. But a good 30% will go on to develop cirrhosis. And once they develop cirrhosis, every year, that's a 7% chance that 7 out of 100 of these individuals will develop liver failure every year. And another 1 out of 100, 5 out of 100, will go on to develop hepatocellular carcinoma. And eventually, these two groups of people will either need a liver transplant or they will die. And so the point of treatment, we want to stop them from getting cirrhotic. If they already have liver cirrhosis though, the treatment will not reverse the cirrhosis, except it will still clear the virus, and so it will reduce the chance that they will go on to develop hepatocellular carcinoma. Do you have any questions at this point? Oh, we're good? If you don't ask me questions, I ask a lot of questions. Okay, so I talked about the objectives. So since you didn't ask me any questions, I'm going to ask you questions. No, I'm not going to ask you questions. I will ask questions, but it's just to test how much you know. In your post-test questions, these things are there. The questions are for you to pay attention so that in the end, I will hear a big chorus of answers from all of you, okay? All right, so first question. Hepatitis C is most commonly transmitted as a blood-borne pathogen. True or false? Don't give me an answer. We're just checking how much you know. You should obtain a hepatitis C viral load with patients who have hepatitis C. True or false? Don't give me an answer. I said it already though, so I hope you remember it. The following agents are all new modalities for managing hepatitis C, except A, interferon, B, Harvoni, C, Viperapax, D, telaprevir. It should have been PRE, but telaprevir. Next, sofosbuvir. So you pick one that you think is a new treatment. I already kind of said the answer when I talked about old treatments, so let's see. Okay, so we're going to do just about five things. We'll look at the virus, we'll look at the signs and symptoms, we'll look at the treatment, and then we will discuss how it's tested and what the government is doing. I asked a couple of patients to be here, but they were not able to make it. One of them was really upset when I told her that because of her stage of liver disease, Medicaid will not pay for her meds. She really bust out in my office. This doesn't make any sense. Why do I have to get sicker before they will treat me? So I asked her, you know what, why don't you come and express your feelings when I give the talk? But I think she wasn't able to make it. So let's look at the virus. So this is a picture of the hepatitis C virus. It's a circular virus, RNA virus, enveloped virus, and it measures about 55 nanometers. So this is the little virus that is causing all the trouble. The reason why it gets to the liver is that it needs a specific receptor to be able to enter a cell. And it still happens that it is only the liver cells that have those things on them. And that is why when it gets into the body, it preferentially goes to the liver. There is some proof that it's able to multiply in some lymph nodes because in other places, but primarily, it's placed, if you measure, you know, if you took different pieces of tissue to check for hepatitis C, you would find it in highest concentration in the liver. This is an electron microscope imaging of the virus. And over the last 10 years or so, your tax dollars have really been working. People have been able to do research to be able to type out the whole DNA of the hepatitis C virus And once the genome was identified, hooray, everybody in the lab, at least the people who do research, had a field day. It meant that now they could synthesize or find out points of the DNA where they could stop the virus from multiplying. And that is why we have treatments that work today. It's bench research that yields. So when you're paying your taxes, pay everything, don't withhold your taxes, because they help to promote medical research. The other thing that has helped hepatitis C treatment is the ability to culture the virus in cells. In the past, the virus could not be cultured in a cell, but now they're able to do so. So they're able to replicate the virus and use the science behind the DNA structure to be able to come up with these new medications. So prior to 1992, it was called the non-A, non-B virus. It didn't have a name. Two scientists came up, were able to isolate the virus, because they found that apart from those who were having hepatitis A and B, there was another form of hepatitis that was being transmitted to people receiving blood products and people who primarily were injection drug users. And so these scientists, after being able to find out that, oh, this is the virus, they decided to call it C, just because there was an A and there was a B. So Hep C has no reason to be called Hep C, but just by virtue of Audrey. It has high genetic diversity because I told you it was an RNA virus, and so all it does is instruct the DNA to make some more RNA, and it's not a duplicate virus, so it doesn't have the smartness to fix itself as it multiplies, and so it makes a lot of mistakes. So it actually, in any one individual who has hepatitis C, if you took a blood sample and you tested it, you will find that the Hep C virus has different forms of it. And so in one individual, we call it the quasi species. So it's not just one type of Hep C. It's made several mistakes, but hey, it's still thriving and surviving. And then in any population, let's say the United States or Egypt or some other place, when you take the hepatitis C virus, you realize that even in a particular country, there are a lot of changes. And because it multiplies so much, there are 6 different genotypes and over 100 subtypes. So for example, which I'll show you in a minute, in the United States, the predominant virus is genotype 1. So don't forget that, genotype 1 in the United States. If you go to a place like Egypt, the predominant genotype is genotype 4. If you go to South Africa, it's genotype 5. And so in any one country, the predominant genotype is different. However, because there's so much international travel in Sioux City, I see patients with genotype 4, 5, you know, I haven't seen too much of 5 because it's such a small number, but you would invariably see different genotypes. But in the US, predominantly you will see genotype 1. Now, what is the relevance of the genotypes? Extremely important, because if you have a genotype that is in a place where people can afford medications, there will be research done, right? They will try to get rid of it. Well, genotype 1 is very common in the United States. And in the US, I'll talk about a certain thing. It's called willingness to treat for quality of adjusted life years. If there's a medical problem, the country would have to decide, is it worth treating this infection? Well, in the US, our ability or willingness to treat per every year gain is about $100,000, $50,000 to $100,000. This will not be possible in a place like Sierra Leone, right? So if you have an expensive medication in a country where people can afford to pay, it would get taken care of, right? Well, the unfortunate thing was, back in the day when Pregnitron was the main form of treatment, genotype 1 was the one with the lowest cure rate, meaning the response to treatment was like sometimes as low as 40% and sometimes 60%, while genotype 2 and 3 was higher, it was about 80%. Well, today with the newer treatments, the response rate is almost 100%. But then what is happening is that most of the newer drugs that have come out are targeted towards genotype 1. There's more background data, and so patients who have genotype 1 are more likely to get on these newer agents. I already talked about the liver-specific expression of MIR-122. That is the protein that helps the virus to get into liver cells. Do you have any questions at this point? What is is a predominant genotype in the United States? One, you guys are smart. What is the predominant genotype in South Africa? Wow, that is good. You had a question?
Yeah, thank you. I'm not sure if you said it because I was taking a lot of notes during this. Do the different genotypes have a different cure rate with this new oral drug, or do they all get cured by it?
It depends on the drug. Some of the drugs are very, like a drug like, we'll get to it, but some of the drugs have a, most of them I would say about 100%, and it's not a big difference. In some of the studies it will say 97% and then 94%, but with the newer drugs I haven't seen anything as low as even 83%. The only rather factor causing a difference is whether somebody already has cirrhosis or not, meaning the liver is already advanced. And I don't know if it's the presence of the fibrosis that reduces the response rate somehow. Because the virus actually does not destroy, it's not a cytopathic virus. You know, some viruses enter a cell and literally destroy the cell. Hepatitis C doesn't do that. What it does is to mount a very strong immune response that rather causes a lot of collagen and fiber to be laid inside the liver. So the liver just gets harder and harder and harder with time. Okay, good. So that was a good question. All right. So 75% of those who harbor hepatitis C in the United States were born between 1945 and 1965. And in this population, so all those who are turning 50 this year, up to those who are turning 70 this year, have a higher chance of having hepatitis C. So when they were teenagers, they were teenagers between 1960 and 1975, thereabout. What do you think they were doing? What? Somebody said having sex and doing drugs. That was the hippie movement. Do you remember? Yeah, you heard about the hippie movement, right? And then even those who went into the army, I mean, I have several patients who started using drugs when they went to Vietnam. I mean, a lot of them, to them, actually they packed cigarettes in their army bags. I mean, they just went high on everything that could make a human being go high. So a lot of them, I mean, that's not to slight them or anything, but I think it's a reality, right? We just have to accept it and put it in our, comprehensively in our management modules. And a lot of them don't know it. I mean, I know some really high profile people who have it. They didn't know it. They were just getting tired and tired until someone tested for it. So in your history taking, you should, whenever you take a history for hepatitis C, you have to try and at least find out how they got hepatitis C. A lot of them might tell you, you know, I exchanged drugs or I used drugs with someone. And unfortunately, hepatitis C virus is still being transmitted. Actually, as I speak, there's an outbreak in Indiana right now. And there's also an outbreak among men who have sex with men. And I'll talk about that and the factors that's going into it. So for the rest of the population outside of 1945 to 1965, the rate of hepatitis C is only 0.8%. And we already talked about the long-term effects, but we talked about the systems of infection in a good 75 to 85%. Within 20 years, 30% of these individuals will develop cirrhosis, and they'll progress to liver failure, and they'll progress to hepatocellular cancer. This virus multiplies fast. Now, 10 to the power 12 is 10 to the power 12 zeros. For each hepatitis C virus, that's how many particles are produced in a day. Can you imagine? So that's quite a lot. And hepatitis C is the number one cause of patients undergoing liver transplantation in the United States. And since every liver has this MIR-122, what do you think is going to happen to the new liver? Just tell me, it's going to get disease. Actually, theirs is even faster. So it's important to treat patients for hepatitis C before. I still don't get why they would, you know, transplantation would be done when there's obviously uncured hepatitis C, but I suppose, you know, if it's your life, whether your hep C is cured or not, you need a liver, you want it done. And it's also it's responsible for 40% of the cases of chronic liver disease. And in 2007, the mortality C attributable to hepatitis C surpass that of HIV? Only in this country, though. HIV is still a big global problem, and in the US, it costs $1 billion in healthcare costs. So I already talked about these genotypes, so we'll skip it fast. The only thing I'd like you to know is that genotype 5 is less than 1% of the global disease burden. I suppose that's why I never really see genotype 5, and it's in South Africa. And genotype 1 makes up 46% of the worldwide burden of hepatitis C. The rest of the genotype 3 also makes up 30%, and then 2, 4, and 6 make up only 22%. So, and I'll just show you slides. I don't know if it's easy to see in the back, but it's just to show you, this is genotype 1, it's mostly in the US, Nigeria, genotype 2, mostly in West Africa, and genotype 3, genotype 5, and this is genotype 6. As you can see, genotype 5 is, see how Egypt and all that is covered. Okay. This is the genotype 4 for Egypt, sorry. This one here. Okay, so let me skip that, you can't see it. And this one gives you the relative prevalence of genotypes by region. The bigger the circle, the more people are infected. So this is the North America circle. This is for the Caribbean. South America is a big circle in Asia. And a big one here too in the Middle East. Big one in North America, in Egypt. A little bit of a circle in Europe, not too big. And then in Russia and in Africa and then South Africa. Okay, so transmission. Where would you find hepatitis C in the body? Mostly in the blood, saliva, cerebrospinal fluid. For patients who develop ascites, if you tap their ascites fluid, you would find hepatitis C virus. But it's not all transmitted that way. Most commonly, it's blood-to-blood transfusion. And it's thought that even the hepatitis C injection drug users, it's thought that maybe the older, the veteran drug users who have Hep C, in the process of teaching the new recruits, may do it on them and try to demonstrate it, and that's how it gets transmitted, and probably not due to a scarcity of needles. It's the process of teaching people how to use IV drugs. And these days, and this is outside of Hep C lecture, but IV drug use is on the increase, especially in white, young teenagers in Connecticut, Massachusetts. For some reason, it's just, and even in Indiana, what is going on is a high degree of injection drug use among teenagers, and they're very affluent children. In the past, IV drug used to be poor, black, not going to school. These are educated children in very well-to-do universities, and I don't want to mention some politicians' kids, but IV drug use is on the increase in the country. How did they just work? Don't have anything to do with sex drugs. Anyway. But that's how hepatitis C is transmitted. It is found in the semen, but sex is not a very effective means of transmitting hepatitis C. And here's how we know. Personally, and also in the literature, I have taken care of several patients with hepatitis C. And so long as they're in a monogamous relationship, their spouses test negative. Their spouses don't have it, and they haven't used any protection because they didn't even know they have it. And so here's where you come in as a healthcare provider. Sometimes people find it difficult discussing sexual things with a physician. And so I have patients, as soon as the partner is diagnosed, they completely stop having sex because they think they're going to get it. So you should advise patients who are in a monogamous relationship that the chances of transmitting it this way are very low. Almost nil. However, there have been other cases where when they test the species-specific type in a one and another individual, especially in men who have sex with men, they find that they're very similar. And so it's unclear whether it's the more of the mucosal tears that go with their sexual activity, or the fact that, in addition, a lot of these same population may also be using drugs. So whether it's the drug that actually causes the transmission versus the sex is unclear. But I just want to make that clear that, you know, Sexual transmission is not a very effective mode of transmitting hepatitis C. And then mother to child transmission is also extremely minimal, to the point that there have been just been a couple of cases where during a cesarean section, after the baby is born, they find out the child was infected. And just as a side note, if you have a mother who gives a Hep C infected mother who gives birth to a child with hepatitis C, you do not test the baby until they're 18 months old, because the results will not be valid. The disease wouldn't have had time to establish itself, so you have to wait till that child is a year and a half before you test them for the virus. So that's one. Does it get transmitted through breast milk? It's not very efficient, it's not been reported, and so in the guidelines, Hep C infected mothers are encouraged to breastfeed their children because the benefits of breastfeeding outweigh the risks. In economically developed countries, IV drug use is a major form of transmission. WHO, I already talked about the number of people infected. And in developed countries, hepatitis C virus is prevalent in 1 to 2% of the population. In Egypt, though, the prevalence is 30%. 1 out of every 3 patients has hepatitis C. And they think it was due to a public health measure. I think it was schistosomiasis or some other condition that, or one of the parasitic diseases where they had to reuse needles to vaccinate a lot of people or treat a lot of, like, mass vaccinations in those days when, that's the thought, but it's 30%. I was shocked to find that. Anyway, so do you have any questions on transmission? Okay, the only time condoms come in is when a patient is on ribavirin. If you put, in those days, you know, before the era of these newer drugs, patients took Pegasys and ribavirin, and even in these days, ribavirin boosted regimens seem to give a better chance of cure. Ribavirin, I'll show you the picture of it, it's highly, highly, you know, it causes a lot of congenital defects. And so whenever you start a patient on anything that contains ribavirin, you ask them to use condoms, like you said, and also if it's a man, the patient's wife has to start using oral contraception. Even though they're not your patients, you have to make sure they're using oral contraception. If it's a woman you're treating, you have to warn them about congenital birth defects. That's something that you should never forget. So that was a good question. Any questions on transmission? Are you bored yet? Okay, there's a question. Is there a hand in the back?
Yeah. Okay, so it's not transmitted by sex.
I'm sorry.
It's not transmitted by sex.
Not that we know of. There's still a lot of debate going on, and you would think it was transmitted by sex. I mean, when people get married for 40 years, you would think that if it's going to be transmitted, that's the best way to transmit it, right? I mean, assuming they even have sex once every 2 weeks, that's 26 times a year times 40. You would think that they would transmit it, but it's not efficiently transmitted that way. Their partners just don't have it.
So usually just only by needles,
yes.
That's the only way they've actually proved it.
Well, that's the most efficient way of transmitting it. But you know what? Knowledge changes every day. Knowledge is never permanent. And so maybe by what we're using to test Hep C today, we're not seeing any changes. Is it causing some silent pathogenic changes in the spouse that we don't know as of today? Who knows what we'll find out in a year from now? But at this point, it's not an efficient means of transmitting. Unlike hepatitis B, where people go to Tijuana, Mexico. I have several patients who go on Mexico vacation alone and come back and they're all yellow because they've acquired sexually transmitted hepatitis B that way, right? So hepatitis C is not transmitted efficiently that way. Okay, here's the thing about alcohol. Alcohol ingestion increases the progression to cirrhosis by 100-fold. Can you imagine that? 100-fold. Just in the last 6 months alone, almost every 2 weeks, I see a 29 to 40 year old woman who has liver failure or cirrhosis from a combination of drinking too much and having hepatitis C. How can you have cirrhosis of the liver at 35? But yes, they do. Teenagers get wild, drink, do all sorts of things. And by the time they're 35, when they should be productive, I mean, it breaks my heart. I just shake my head. What can I do? They're not my family members. That's their lifestyle. They've acquired an addictive habit. But please counsel your patients about alcohol. And I know they make it look all glamorous on TV, Heineken, and this, that, but you know, it causes liver disease. And the other thing a lot of people don't know, that women progress to cirrhosis twice as fast as men. I don't know if you know that. If a woman and a man sit down to drink, and they both get a glass of wine, and they drink a glass of wine every day, the woman's progression to liver disease is twice as fast. So those of you who love your tequilas and your margaritas, so alcohol by itself causes liver disease. The only difference is that Hep C causes a macro big nodule cirrhosis, and alcohol causes a micro nodular cirrhosis. Okay, so the person got infection. What happens to them? Is there a way of darkening the light here a little bit? If you can, okay. So here's what happens when somebody gets infected. I found this very interesting. Within 2 days of getting infected, you can detect hepatitis C virus. 2 days, 2 to 3 days, the virus is busy. Because I told you it has a rate of 10 to the power 12 of multiplication, right, per day. So within 2 days, the test is positive, and you can find out if somebody has hepatitis C. Secondly, the antibodies that we normally use take about 6 to 8 weeks before they become detectable. So this is what happens when somebody gets infected. Immediately within 2 days, this is the hepatitis C viral load. It stays, it goes up and stays constant. It doesn't change. And so there's actually, in reality, a lot of the insurance companies will want you to have a viral load that is done within the past year. In reality, we don't need to be repeating viral loads. They got Hep C, they got it. It's not clearing. If you don't treat it, it won't go anywhere. On the other hand, the antibodies, which take about 6 weeks to start showing up, they stay up for a long time, and they go up and up. So if you're measuring the titers, every year they would increase. This is months and years. And then the other interesting thing is that this is your acute hepatitis. So this is ALT. Your liver enzymes will shoot up. That is when if you're ill, really ill, with a jaundice that looks like hepatitis A, your liver enzymes will be in the 3,000s. But then they shoot down very low, about 5 months, and they fluctuate over time. By the time the patient is, this is 5 years, by the time you get to 20 years, the liver is now cirrhotic. And so it has stopped producing a lot of liver enzymes. So here's another clinical mistake people make. Somebody will come to them and say, I'm tired all the time. Did they use drugs? Yes. They check the liver enzymes. Oh, it's normal. They can't have Hep C. No. They probably have really advanced hepatitis C. I see that a lot. You know, someone gets referred to me and they'll say, but their liver enzymes are normal. Yes, they're normal because the liver is so shrunken and shriveled, it has no active hepatocytes to produce any liver enzymes. So one take home you should know today, normal liver enzymes is not equal to absence of liver disease or hepatitis C. But you should look for other things like low platelets, tiredness, increased bilirubin, or increased coagulopathy or INR. Those are some of the things that you should use. Okay, so it's a silent killer. Yes? Okay, so jaundice we will talk about over here. And you only get jaundice when you start decompensating. So let's say you have a car. Most people have a spare tire, right? So if one tire is bad, the other three may work. If the one goes really bad, you can just go into your wherever you keep your other tire and just slap it on, and you'll be getting by. But you know, sooner than later, you've got to pass by to a place where you can get your tires fixed, right? When jaundice shows up, now you can have jaundice in acute hepatitis because jaundice is really just a high level of bilirubin. However, in chronic liver disease, the liver kind of tries to get by. Okay, most of us have fibrosis, but hey, we're survivors, we're tough, we can do the job. We can produce albumin, we can produce the fibrinogen, we can produce what you need to keep things going. Then it gets to a stage where we call it now decompensated. The liver says, you know what? I've had this. I can't do this anymore. This is too much for the few of us left. So that is when you start seeing jaundice. So by the time a patient gets jaundice, it's not just jaundice. Their abdomen gets a little bigger. They have ascites. Their bilirubin starts creeping from about 2 to 2.4. It's going up, sometimes it's 3, it comes down, they're sleepy, you're talking to them and they're drowsy, or they tell you they can't think straight. The liver is getting decompensated. And although you may be able to manage that acute episode, it's the sign that you should refer them for liver transplant. Because if you allow them to keep getting readmitted with these short episodes of decompensation, you will get to a state where the liver has failed and you may not be able to do anything. So that was a good question. Okay, all right. So what does it do to the liver? Like I said, it doesn't chew up the liver. It just lays down a lot of unnecessary hay and fiber that cause the liver to get harder and harder. And I'll talk about the stages of fibrosis. I asked somebody to bring me models. Did they get here?
No.
Did you bring them? Okay, you can pass around. There are 6 of them. You can kindly pull one on each table and let them pass it around to see the stages of fibrosis. Okay, so what are the symptoms of hepatitis C? People will have no symptoms. By the time they get fatigued, they're at stage 3 or 4. And sometimes with the fatigue, you can't tell if it's because they're just depressed, is it because they're already in their 50s and, you know, midlife and all that. But people do get tired. For those who get to the stage of cirrhosis, because their estrogen, testosterone, metabolism goes up, they start developing, some of the men start developing breasts. So gynecomastia, whenever you see a patient with gynecomastia, think about chronic liver disease. And then they get confused, erectile dysfunction, or they start coughing up blood. And I'll show you a picture of esophageal varices. There are 6 models, so you can place one about every 4 tables or so and let them look at it. But please pay attention though. Okay. So this is a picture of somebody who is jaundiced. Their eyes get yellow. This is a man with advanced liver disease. His face is not only yellow, but his abdomen is really enlarged as well. I don't want to describe it because I'll get into trouble, but it's really big. And this is what cirrhosis of the liver looks like. This is a normal liver, and this is a cirrhosed liver. It's hard, it's rough, it's got nodules on it. The liver is supposed to be smooth and soft, but by the time it's cirrhotic, it's really hard and coarse. So I talk compensated cirrhosis. It's able to do the job. You might find a little bit of a low platelet. They get a little tired. And then once they have ascites, they start coughing up blood. They start getting these big veins on their abdomen. This gentleman doesn't have the head of Medusa, but there's a clinical sign called the head of Medusa where the veins radiate from the umbilicus. And it's supposed to be pathognomonic for liver disease. And their skin gets thick. They start coming into the hospital. Their family members will tell you they can't think straight or they're always sleepy. It means that the liver is decompensating. And this is a picture of an actual cirrhotic liver. And then there are extrahepatic manifestations of hepatitis C. And I don't know how many more we'll find in the next few years, but lichen planus is a condition which has been linked to hepatitis C. And the minute the hepatitis C is cured, the condition goes away completely. Same for sporadic porphyria cutanea tarda. There are 2 forms of porphyria cutanea tarda. There's a familial one which runs in families. But if somebody who doesn't have a family history of porphyria cutanea tarda presents with this condition, you should think about hepatitis C and check for it. And I actually took care of a patient whose skin lesions cleared completely, and that was even in the era of Pegintron, but it completely went away. And then these are the esophageal varices. This is just to give you an idea of what happens. I'll show you the structure of the liver, but when the liver gets hard, the veins that go through it cannot flow anymore. And you know, you have the veins getting into your venous return to your heart, going through your inferior vena cava. And then when it gets to the liver, it breaks up into little veins that go through the liver. If the liver is sclerosed, the veins cannot return to the heart in an easy fashion. So they have to find outlets. And that is why you form the caput medusa, the head of medusa in the abdominal wall. And the same process goes on in the esophagus and their stomach lining. So if you look over here, these veins are very engorged. This is the stomach. This is an actual patient with a cross-section of what their esophagus looks like. And you would find these thick veins that would pop open, and so they'll suddenly start coughing up lots of blood. And it's a sign of, it's a secondary effect of the fact that the liver is so cirrhosed. And this is an image of hepatocellular carcinoma. And I talked about the extrahepatic manifestations, the B-cell lymphoproliferative disorders, membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, Sjögren's syndrome, and all these improve after treatment for hepatitis C. Okay, any questions on signs and symptoms before we start testing our patient? So you have a patient, they came in with a big, you know, ascites, maybe a little jaundice, or maybe they're not jaundice. There's just a 55-year-old guy in the practice who says they're tired all the time and their liver enzymes are maybe a teeny bit up. How do you test this patient? If you have any questions on signs and symptoms, you can ask and then I'll go on to test it. No questions? Okay, let's go. So how do we test the patient? I can't even see it from here, so I don't know how you guys can see it. Okay, we'll just talk about it. So CDC issued guidelines. Everybody between 45 to 65 has got to be tested. Anybody who's actively using drugs?
Question.
Oh, a question.
Yes. This is back a few slides, but when you said that the instance of getting cirrhosis is 100-fold more with hepatitis C, is it different if they've been treated?
No, the 100-fold more was alcohol.
Right. But if they have hep C and it develops into cirrhosis, if they are treated for the hep C, is that 100-fold statistic still true?
If they keep drinking?
Yes.
Oh, yes, definitely. In fact, I tell my hep C patients, you know, one of them saw me 2 weeks ago. He said, well, I have to approve their hep C drugs. And so he told me, well, I took a drink last week. And I'm sure he wished he hadn't told me because I told him I cannot go on. I tell my hep C patients, if you don't stop drinking, why do you want the state to spend $95,000 preventing something that you are going to cost anyway? I mean, put the money aside. Why would you even bother? The point is to stop cirrhosis. It's not just to mentally get hep C off your mind. We are doing something, we're stopping cirrhosis. But you are actively drinking and causing the same thing. There is no point. If you want to keep drinking, don't get your hep C treated, just go on having your jolly good time, and because there's no point in treating hep C. You actually will get rid of the virus, but you will still have cirrhosis, so there was really no point. I mean, these days, the pill is easy to take, it has no side effect, but in those days when it was pegylated interferon and people were coming with schizophrenia and low white cell count, I mean, it was just a stress on the patients and us, people would lose their hair. It was just a very difficult treatment. Why would you put all of us through this if you will continue to drink? And the states have gotten smart, at least Medicaid. If you have any sign that you're drinking, they will not approve your medications. They just won't. I don't know if they do random tests. I had a patient who I said everything. He said he was depressed and he went into the ER crying. They checked his alcohol level, it was high. I didn't even know that. I just got a letter that said he wasn't approved. I said, why was he not approved? And then he said he had gone to the ER and his alcohol level was high. So he's not going to get his treatment. So. That's a long answer to your question, but yeah. Okay. All right, so the age groups, everybody who's actively using drugs should be tested. patients on dialysis should be tested. Patients who have received transplants should be tested, because if you receive any form of transplant, not just a liver transplant, from a patient who has hep C, chances of getting hep C is going to be 100%, because I already told you, each virus goes through 10 to the power 12 multiplication in a day. So there are classes of people who should be tested for hep C, and you don't have to do it every time. The recommendation is to test just once. And the testing is the antibody test. Once it's done, the next step is the viral load, and I told you why, right? Excuse me. It's called the nucleic acid test. There are 6 different assays for the antibodies. There's even a rapid test. But once somebody has the antibody, they could be one of the 10 people who have cleared the virus. So you don't want to start them on treatment. You always want to check the viral load. And if it's high, it's high. They have it. And that's the point at which you might want to refer to a specialist for treatment. Then the other thing you should check is the genotype. No insurance company would approve any hep C treatment without the genotype. So you need to know that. And besides the insurance company, the genotype determines the treatment, as I will show you in a minute. So first 3 things: antibody test, viral load, and hepatitis C genotype. The next is the liver biopsy, and this is important to save the progression of cirrhosis. I'm sure you'll get the models come around. The standard way of staging cirrhosis is 0, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4. And you might find something else that's called grade, and here's how I explain it to my patients. Take it that you're going from, are you bored yet? Okay. Take it that you're going from here to Omaha. Omaha is cirrhosis, Sioux City is really good, we're stage 0. So the stage at which you are on your way to getting to Omaha is the stage of liver disease. If you get to Onawa, you might be at stage 2, and you're looking at the degree of fibrosis and the portal triad and the degree of activity that's going on there. If you get to, what is that, exit 75? Missouri Valley. If you get to Missouri Valley, you're probably at a stage 3 out of 4. If you get to Omaha, you do have your cirrhosis and it's stage 4. Another thing you would find on the biopsies is they'll tell you the grade. The grade is just a degree of how active or the degree of inflammation going on in the liver. And here's what I tell my patients. It's like on your way to Omaha, your car got caught on fire. If it's burning just a little bit, we'll say it's grade 1. If it's burning a lot, we'll say it's grade 4. So you can be close to Omaha, you have stage 4 disease, but your grade may be grade 1. And you can have only stage 1 disease, but your grade may be grade 4, because there's a lot of inflammation going on in the liver. Is that clear? Okay. So the liver biopsy has been the traditional way of testing the progression to cirrhosis, and it tells us different things. Back in the day when people didn't want to be on interferon anyway, what the SAGE did was to make people decide, why do you want to be on this toxic treatment? Because they had to be on treatment for a whole year. Some people missed days from work. And right after you get the peg intron, 2 days, you have a high fever of 103. People lost their hair. So once you get to know that your stage is maybe stage 1, you can decide, I'm not going to treat, I'll just wait. I can do this later. Or some people will say, oh, I have this job, I'm going to switch jobs in 2, or I'm going to retire in 2 years. When I retire and I have plenty of time, then I'll get on treatment. So that was the value of the liver biopsy. So it kind of gave you a sense of, okay, let's hurry. You're going to get Omaha. We got to take care of this quick. Or, you know what? Maybe I'm one of the 70% of people who would not progress. So the liver biopsy is important. However, since the liver biopsy has been in use, it's not perfect. I've had patients who look clearly cirrhotic, and the liver biopsy will say they're at stage 1. That is because we need to get a good 20 millimeters of tissue, and it also depends on the pathologist looking at it. So I've had a few patients who've been turned down because their stage of liver disease is not advanced enough, and I've asked them to repeat the liver biopsy. But people got smart. They realized that, you know what, maybe we don't really need to biopsy the liver. We can do something else that will tell us if the liver is fibrosed or not. So people have looked at certain things that the liver does, and I'll go over them, and they've come up with a test called FibroSure that it just measures blood, different blood tests, puts it in a little algorithm, and it pops out a number. And the states will accept this number as a measure of cirrhosis. Again, it's not perfect. And then there's another thing called the FibroScan. Because essentially, when the liver is fibrosed, it's hard, right? It's getting harder. So if there's a way of measuring the hardness of the liver, it will be good enough. So what they do is an ultrasound. It takes 10 different shots of the liver. They measure it in kilopascals. And then they average the 10 and pop out a number. If it's less than 8, the chance that a patient is cirrhotic is very little. If it's above 12, then the chance is pretty high. However, this test has its limitations. If, for any reason, whoever is doing the ultrasound doesn't take good quality pictures, or they get less than 10, then it's not a perfect number. And it's way much more, I don't know the actual cost, but it's more expensive than doing the liver biopsy. Okay, then other tests that need to be performed. Once somebody has cirrhosis, every 6 to 12 months, they need to have an ultrasound to check for liver cancer. They need to have an EGD every now and then to check for cirrhosis and start them on all the medications that I use in liver disease. And then the alpha-fetoprotein is not a perfect marker, but for those who have cirrhosis, it tells them if they're getting liver cancer or not. And then, of course, every Hep C patient should have some baseline studies, HIV tests, complete blood counts, and most people will also rule them out for alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, hemochromatosis, and Wilson's disease. And another thing I don't want you to forget, every Hep C infected patient, whether they are stage 0, stage 4, ought to have testing for hepatitis A and B. And here is the reason why. If you find that they are not immune to hepatitis A and B, you should give them a vaccine. Reason being that anybody who has Hep C, for some reason, if they went to one of the restaurants in town and they ate beef that had hepatitis A, they will get fulminant liver failure and die. So patients who have Hep C, when they get hepatitis A or B infection, they develop rapid liver failure. So you should make sure that all the patients in your practice, whether you're referring them to a specialist or not, if they have hepatitis C, that you check for A and B and vaccinate them. So this is a comparison of the different methods of grading liver fibrosis. The Metavir score is the normal one using a liver biopsy. And the FibroScan equivalent for, like, for stage 1, is less than 7.1 for FibroScan, and cirrhosis is 12.1. This is the fibro test. We don't have these here in Sioux City, so I haven't used them, but I'll show you what it looks like. This is how the normal liver looks like. I won't go into details, and this is how bridging. So look at a nice normal liver with sheets of cells, and then when it gets fibrosed, this is what it looks like under pathology. This is the thing, these are the 6 things that go into testing, the FibroSure. We already talked about the FibroScan and the score of whether somebody has cirrhosis or they don't have cirrhosis. This is a picture of the Alpha FibroScan machine, and it's being performed on someone. So let's treat our patients. We gotta be fast now. They're about to die. They're getting to Omaha. Okay. Goals of treatment. We have to eradicate the virus. There are some terms I want you to familiarize yourself with, and we'll move on. Early virological response is at 12 weeks. We call it the EVR. Usually, for most of these drugs, if in 4 weeks the viral load is still detectable, chances are the medication wouldn't work. We test an end of treatment response, the ETR. If it's negative, it's good, but you tell your patients not to get excited. The test of cure for hepatitis C is at 6 months. These days, the FDA has approved 3 months because of how good the new agents are. But historically, somebody finishes treating with Hep C, you tell them, okay, don't have a party just yet. Wait for 6 months, we'll check the viral load, because the virus can still be multiplying. If your viral load is detectable at six months, boy, it didn't work. We call it that you've relapsed. And there are some that non-responders, they don't respond even at the end of treatment. So why we treat? We want to achieve SBR. What is the importance? I already have cirrhosis. Okay. So that's a 70% reduction in progression to hepatocellular carcinoma once You achieve SDR and a 90% reduction in liver-related mortality like tiredness, esophageal varices, etc. And I already told you that most of the extrahepatic manifestations completely resolve. Even those who have lymphoproliferative disorders like lymphoma, etc., they're able to achieve 75% remission. For stage 1 and 2 patients, somebody followed 820 patients over 20 years, and they found that for those who were treated and achieved SBR, their survival was 93%. Those who failed treatment, 82%. No treatment, 88%. So we do know that no matter the stage of hepatitis C or no matter the stage of liver disease, treatment works. I think we're running out of time, so I'll skip through a lot of things. I've talked about the progression of treatment, interferon, pegylated interferon, ribavirin. These days are what we call the DAAs, direct acting antiviral agents. There's telaprevir, I'll show you a picture of that. Its other name is Incivic. These are NS348 serine protease inhibitors. Bosiprevir, also called Betrelis. And then Zovaldi, which has really been an amazing drug. It acts through a different mechanism, which I'll show you in a minute. And then there's the Curapac, which came out about a year or two ago, right? About a year or two ago. And it's also been extremely useful. So just keep your eyes on the board. We'll be done pretty soon. The Curapac is a combination of four drugs at four different mechanisms of action, and we'll look at that in a moment. And I'll skip this because I think I've repeated it over, you know, how the progression of treatment has been. I just showed you a little somebody dancing because there are new treatments around. Okay, so basic research was important in getting us where we are today. I talked about the virus, positive-stranded RNA virus. So let me show you the life cycle. Let me just jump off this. Again, it's hard to see, but this is what happens when hepatitis C encounters a cell. It needs that MIR-122 to get inside the cell. Once it gets in, it uses its own proteins. We call them the protein NS348 proteins to start breaking down its own proteins. It breaks them down into 10 non-structural proteins, and these get to work quickly as polymerase, using the body's enzymes and the body's resources to start making new RNA. No wonder they get tired. I mean, if one virus is making 10 to the power 12 new viruses with your energy and your food, you're going to get tired. So they start using the body's resources to make new viruses. They get to the cell membrane, the nuclear membrane, set up shop, get into the endoplasmic reticulum, get busy, reproduce, form new membranes, and hey, out, they go to infect new cells. So that is how the cycle is. And on a drug level, so let's go back here. The new slide I'm going to show you is at this level here, just magnified. And it's hard to see, but this here is the MIR-122. It's a drug target. A new drug is going to come out called Miroversin. It's still in testing. They hope to be able to block it on the human. Remember, this is part of your body's hepatocyte membrane. They're going to try and block this, and once it's blocked, they hope the virus will not get into the body. And then on the RNA that has been formed, there are various areas they're looking at blocking. These envelope proteins are structural proteins, and the core proteins, they're coming up with drugs to treat it. Then the NS3 was one of the first new agents that got us really excited after Pegintron. It was telaprevir and bosiprevir. But as I'll show you in a minute, apart from being incorporated in some of the drug regimens, they're telling us in 2015, don't even use it because there are other newer ones. Why do you want to put a patient through something that is inferior to what other things are on the market? But on the other hand, you're saying that the stage 1 and 2 people cannot be treated. Anyway, they're saying we shouldn't use it at this time. So this is the NS3 blockers, and they blocked, it was NS3 and NS4A blockers. And these are the really cool new ones. The NS5A, the Flatazir, and I'll talk about a few more. And the nucleoside and non-nucleoside inhibitors, which block the NS5B protein, the NSIB on the RNA of the hepatitis C virus. And other targets include the cyclosporine A. There are other drugs that are in development. And after this, Hep more Hep C virus, and then it leaves the cell. So I just wanted you to see that the newer drugs didn't just come out of the blue. They targeted them. So this is a picture of pegylated interferon. These were the first ones that were used, and then they came out with a Proclic. They were very popular. I prescribed it to several patients, but these days, nobody's going to use it, except genotype 4, where it can be used in part of a regimen. But I think the drug company announced that they have stopped producing it. I hope nobody was buying them. And then this is what ribavirin looks like. It's thought to work by different mechanisms. It inhibits cellular inosin. It causes confusion to the hepatitis C cell virus, basically. They think it acts through four different means. It promotes mutagenicity of RNA viruses, and it might modulate the immune response. I told you that the virus doesn't actually destroy cells. It sets up like a huge immune response, which is how pegylated interferon works, because interferons are really cytokines, so they kind of confuse the cell, the virus, and I think that's why it wasn't achieving 100% cure rate. So ribavirin is extremely important. It's the backbone for several regimens. It should never, ever, ever, ever be used as monotherapy because it doesn't work. And it only causes the liver enzymes to go down a little bit. It doesn't work. And remember I told about the congenital defects. If somebody's on ribavirin, they should use protection. Then it's the NS34A serine protease inhibitors, telaprevir. It was marketed by Vertex as Incivic. Bosiprevir was marketed by Merck as Etrelis. The simiprevir or Olisio, tenofovir, peritraprevir, grasoprevir, and sofosprevir. Now, these last three are still included in certain drugs I'll talk about in a minute, but those were the serine protease inhibitors. This is how telaprevir looks like. It's not recommended for a lot of treatments anymore. This is how bosiprevir looked like, Etrelis. Simeprevir or Olisio is still used for some of the regimens. I'll talk about it. And then the novel NS5A nucleoside inhibitors, Ledipasvir, which is, how many of you have seen the Harboni advert? Have you been, well, the Hep C patients are actually watching it. It says, Harboni, talk to your physician about it. Once a day pill and it will cure you forever and ever and ever. Anyway, so that is, Ledipasvir, it's one of the agents in, it was the first single once a day treatment for Hep C that only took 12 weeks to treat. It was marketed by Gilead, and just as an aside, I was reading a little bit about the CEO. Quite interesting. He spent 20 to 25 years just doing research on viruses. He was, you know, one of the brains behind the protease inhibitors for HIV. And I think he should get an award. You know, he saved many lives by his research, you know, discovering what he can do to get rid of viruses in the body. Anyway, and then there's Ovipasvir, which is in Viquiripat, and a lot of newer ones coming out. All you'll be hearing is Vir, probably doesn't mean much to you anyway. Okay, so, and then there's NS5B protease inhibitor, Sofosbuvir, also contained in Harboni. It's in the backbone of several of the regimens. It's also really good. And there's a new one that is in the Viquiripat, it's called Sofosbuvir. So this is how Sofosbuvir looks like. I'm going to kind of skip through it. It was approved December 2013. Achieved SVR rates of over 90% once daily administration. Resistance is minimal. It's very well tolerated. Harboni. This is how it looks like. It's a combination of the Ledipasvir and Sofosbuvir. This is how small it is. Once a day, the patients are really excited about it. This other one is called Aclinda. It goes to Sofosbuvir, was just approved this past July. It's two tablets, but hey, it's better than injections for a year. Viquiripat has four different mechanisms of action. It has four drugs, NS5A, NS5B, NS34A protease inhibitor, plus ritonavir, and you get infected with ribavirin. So five things in action, powerful. It gets almost a 97% cure rate. This is how it looks like. It comes in a blister pack, and we just tell the patient to take these two drugs were that in the morning and this in the evening. So it's really 4 tablets. It's not a pill, but it's good enough. Other medications in the pipeline include the cyclophilin A post-14 targets and the myrovirsen, which is going to target the 1-2-2 target on the liver cells. There are several drugs in the pipeline. That's what this slide is about. This slide you can barely see. It's talking about the different things that are going to, different mechanisms of action. So probably the next 5 years, we're going to be, you know, there'll be several drugs that are going to come on the market. Okay, so let's use all this information to take care of our patients. I'll be really fast. You know, type 1A, these are the current recommendations. Jaclyn's was just approved a month ago, and it's already in the preferred treatments for genotype 1A. And the numbers next to them are their cure rates, 96% for Daclinza and Sovaldi, 99% for Harvoni, 97% for Viekira, and 97% for Olysio and Sovaldi. You know, type 1B, similar, same set of drugs I mentioned. Drugs not to be used in 2015 for genotype 1A, sulfosidine and ribavirin, pegylated interferon not to be used, and definitely not monotherapy with pegylated ribavirin or a direct acting agent. For genotype 2, Daclinza was just approved a month ago, like I said, and you could use Sovaldi and ribavirin. The drugs that you should never use for genotype 2, pegintron alone, ribavirin alone, sorafenib alone. Treatment for genotype 3 is mainly Daclinza together with sulfosphobia, or sulfosphobia and ribavirin, the drugs that you should never use. Treatment for genotype 4, AbbVie just came out with a new drug called Technovi. It's basically Viekirapak with one agent removed, and it seems to work against genotype 4. Who remembers where I said genotype 4 was? 5 is in South Africa, 4, Egypt, right? I just caught you off guard, sorry. Anyway, alternative treatment for genotype 4 drugs you should never use. Treatment for genotype 5 or 6. Wait, and genotype 4 is the only one where currently you can still use sulfosphobia, weight-based ribavirin, plus pegintron. So genotype 4 is the only one that today, 2015, you can still prescribe pegylated interferon. So why the politics? Now I'm saying I'm really done and I'm really done. Why the politics? Most said, as soon as the price of Harvoni came out at $94,500, Sovaldi came out at $80,000, and Viekira Pak was at $83,319, Congress sat up and summoned the CEOs to come and explain why their drugs should cost that much for a treatment. And they defended themselves. They said, hey, we spent 10 years doing research. It cost us billions of dollars. It's going to save lives. You pay for it or leave it. And they couldn't leave it, so they took it. But they took it with a lot of restrictions. And here's how I explain it. Let's just imagine, you know, close your eyes for a moment and imagine a bunch of sick Hep C patients walking towards a cliff. They're going to fall off. It's a steep cliff. They're going to die. They don't even know it. You, the healthcare provider, you know what's going to happen to them. Some of them are like a foot away from dying. Others are 10 meters away. Some people are a mile away. But you know what's going to happen to them. What the states have done is to decide, or maybe what you tell me what you think. Do you think the people that will get there, if you treat them, they will not even come near the cliff? Do you want to treat those people? They are stage 1 and 2. Or do you want to treat those who are 10 meters away from the cliff, or those who are standing at the edge of the cliff? Let's show by hands which group of people want to treat those who are far away. You know, there's no right or wrong answer. You know, think of your sister. If your sister was diagnosed with Hep C, and they have a high viral load, they're at stage 1, they know that this is the treatment, they have Medicaid, they can. It can be given to them, but the state is saying no. And your father, let's, you know, I'm trying to bring it home. Your father, who is 65, has stage 4 disease. Your sister is 35. She has stage 2 disease. Your father is 65. He's completed everything he's going to do in this life. Maybe he just goes fishing. But he has cirrhosis. Who do you want to treat? Okay, let's say you have to make a decision. Your household is being given one drug. Because you can't afford it. I mean, hey, if you're a millionaire, you can order both. Let's assume you don't have money. Your family, or even if you have money, I mean, come on, seriously, how many of you have $84,000 to pay for your, assuming there was no Medicaid, do you have $84,000 to pay for these drugs? Let's assume you have a benevolent person who decides, I love your family, I want to help you, I'm going to give you one drug for your family. Who do you want to treat? Your sister, right? Why? She still has a liver and she still has life. I'm not arguing for or against because I'm not the state, but here is what the state has decided, and not just Iowa, over 35 states in the United States. They have decided if you don't have stage 3 or 4 disease, you are not going to be treated. You will only be treated if you have stage 1 or 2, you can wait. You are not getting treatment. So that is something I want you to think about, and it's a reality for most patients. Who do you say? There's no right or wrong answer. It's just a matter of ethics. And some people have argued, why is it that when you were Pregnantron, you could treat anybody? Now that the drug is expensive, it's as though you're making people feel less human or less valuable, right? Because they have less advanced disease. I already talked about the cost of the drugs. This is the most expensive. But what really happens is that the insurance companies apparently don't really pay $95,500. And it's kind of secret. Nobody knows how much the insurance companies actually pay because nobody talks about it. But several Medicaid programs get it at a discount. Some get up to 46% discounts on these medications, and they administer them to those who have stage 2 or 3. And this is the interval role of infectious disease specialists will come in a moment. Because it's so expensive, and look at the number of medications I went through, they decided that primary care physicians cannot write prescriptions for these medications. You have to be a hepatologist, a gastroenterologist, or an infectious disease specialist before you can prescribe any of these oral regimens. And not only do you have to be a specialist, you need to have a prior authorization. Your lab work and everything have to go to the insurance companies before. Okay, somebody has a question in the back.
When you were talking about all the different medications for like treating the genotype 1, and you have all those percentages of the
cure rate,
how do you decide which medication? And if you try one medication and it isn't successful, then can you go to another medication?
Okay, good question. I'll answer your second part first. Because it's so expensive, the insurance companies have instituted once-a-lifetime policy. You try it, it doesn't work, you blew your chance, that's it. I mean, back in the day when it was Pregnantron, people got retreated. I mean, you could look at different factors and say, okay, this person was on interferon, now there's Pregnantron, I'm going to retry Pregnantron, or maybe I'll change the dose of ribavirin from 400 twice a day to 600. You negotiated with the patient, okay, I'll give it a shot. But this time, one time, move on. But you know, the cure rates are so good that people are not. The other part of your question is, how do you decide? These drugs have a lot of drug interactions. Even though they're free of side effects, they have a lot of drug interactions. You have to check who is on a proton pump inhibitor, especially the HIV meds. A lot of them have cytochrome P450 interactions. And so you have to do a lot of checking. Make sure they're not on anti-epileptic agents, they are not on amiodarone. There's a lot of thought that goes into it. That's why they said, probably that's why it explains why they want the specialist to treat it. For Sioux City, a few years ago, when it was Pregnantron, the gastroenterologist thought it was too much time and work, and it really was. It's a very demanding, to even have one Hep C patient, you need a lot of staff time. So they gave up on Hep C treatment. So it's basically Dr. Lamte and I who treated here in Sioux City. And of course, they're providers in school calls as well. So factors that limit access, you ought to have stage 4 or be cirrhotic. You need to prove that you are abstinent from addictive drugs. It's limited to specialists, once in a lifetime treatment, prior authorization, or a case-by-case basis. As a matter of fact, this morning, one of my patients has a hearing at the state. I was supposed to be on the phone call to determine whether, even though he doesn't meet all these criteria, his situation demands payment for his drugs. So you have the patient, you have the pharmaceutical company, they want to get the drug to the patient, but they have to go to a pharmacy benefit manager who sets all the guidelines, working with the insurance company, whether it's approved, they inform the physician's office, and then the patient gets the medicine. Then the specialty pharmacies who they mushroom to help with this process. The drugs are very expensive, and I suppose they make a lot of money off of it. But they're very, all the patients come back and give me really good feedback. They said they love the specialty pharmacies. They call them all the time. They ask them how they're doing. Who doesn't want love and attention? So the specialty pharmacies are playing a big role. Actual price may be discounted. And this is what the states use to decide that only cirrhotic patients should get the medicine or patients. They use something called the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio over the difference in quality adjusted life years. And in the US, our willingness to pay $50,000 to $100,000 per quality adjusted life year. If the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio is less than $50,000, then it gets paid. When they did it for cirrhosis and stage 3 and 4, they felt that the incremental cost effectiveness ratio, that is the number of good years they would gain, would be less than 50,000. And so that's how come cirrhosis and advanced liver disease, in spite of what you were thinking from an ethical standpoint, this was the economic rationale that was used to approve these medicines. And so the other insurance companies like Blue Cross Blue Shield, they're not really looking at that. If you have stage 1, you get treated. They're not looking at all these, but it's mainly the state program. So there are several patients on Medicaid who've been told you are not sick enough to be treated. And finally, I am really done. And so we talked about transmission. We talked about transmission of hepatitis C. We went through all the testing that needs to be done. I talked about as many drugs as I could. I made you poke the liver. Who didn't touch the liver models? Find it and touch it. And then we talked about the dawn of a new era. 100% cure rates is marvelous. Let's do our post-test questions and go on break. Hepatitis C is mostly transmitted as a blood-borne pathogen. True or false? Very good. So check it out. Next question. You should obtain a hepatitis C viral load in patients. It shouldn't have said patients with Hep C. It should have said patients who test positive for the antibody. True or false? Last question. The following agents are all new modalities for managing Hep C except A, interferon, B, Harbone, C, Vicarapac, D, Telaprevir, E, Sofosbuvir. What's the answer? It wasn't confident enough. What's the answer?
Hey.
Okay, good. Thank you very much. Any other questions?
Do we have any questions? We have one right here. Can you go to the mic?
And there's a mic here if you want to come and make it loud so everybody can hear it. They want to hear you. Is it possible to clear the back? The medicine works every time, because if you think about it, no. Wait, is it possible to clear the virus if you're stage 1? Yes, you can clear it. You see, the stage is what the virus has done to the liver. So what's going on in the liver? Of course, there's a caveat to your question. The more advanced liver disease you have, the poorer your response rate. So even with the newer meds, there are some patients with cirrhosis that they have like 83% cure rates at the 12 weeks, so you have to treat them for 24 weeks. So yes, in a way, the stage of the liver somehow affects the length of treatment and how effective the treatment. But stage one, piece of cake, you'll take care of it. Okay.
Do you see co-infection with different genotypes of hep C, and what kind of drug resistance are you seeing?
I've never seen a co-infection. However, it's in the literature. Especially patients who get treated who still keep using drugs, they might get a new kind of genotype. And I also mentioned that even in any one individual, there's this thing called quasi-species. Because the virus is not smart enough to correct itself, it keeps making mistakes and it just keeps going. Yes. So I have personally not treated somebody with co-infection, but as you can tell, I forgot to mention, some of the drugs are what we call pan-genotypic. While some drugs are very specific for genotype, maybe four or three, some of the drugs treat everything, so you can, I haven't heard of retreatment from a reinfection, but yeah, that can happen.
And the other question is, what kind of resistance is emerging?
You know, I don't think I've actually looked or they didn't understand all the mechanisms of resistance, but they have noticed that with some of the drugs, once you start them on treatment, the patient can have virus come. Unlike HIV, you know, HIV, there's a resistance pattern. You can almost do a genotype or phenotypic analysis to determine if hepatitis C resistance has in part reason. I hope it does, because it'll be a nightmare. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Oh, okay.
In your clinic, do people have to complete immunizations for Hep A and B before you start the treatment?
No, but when they come to me, I recommend it because it has nothing to do with the treatment. I just want them to be safe. So these days there's the twin rates that is given like a month apart. So I check the hepatitis A and B, and then I write it for them, and they get it done either at the community health center or, the public health, or wherever they'll get it. So you can get it at any time. Sort of like when you're traveling, you just want to get the hepatitis A and B vaccine like 2 weeks before you travel. But once once you've gotten the vaccine, it should not stop you from getting the treatment.
One more. For healthcare workers who have had a bloodborne exposure, needle sticks, that kind of thing, how long and at what increments would you recommend that they get tested for hep C?
Okay, the regimen is 6 weeks, 3 months, and 6 months. And with this knowledge of the viral load, it sounds like what we really should be checking is not even the antibody. We should be checking the viral load within 3 days, and we'll know if they have it or not. But just because they may be employed by you, and you want to make sure that 10 years down the road, and the first thing you do whenever somebody gets a needle stick exposure is to check their hep C. Because you don't want them to use their old hep C to come and say they got stuck while they were at your workplace. Because hep C is not one of those infections that limits your employment. Like if you're a healthcare worker with hep C, you can work. I mean, unlike hep B, where you have to make sure you have the vaccine. If you're a healthcare worker with hep C, you are allowed to work. So if you get a needle stick exposure, the first thing is that your hep C status should be obtained, and then 6 weeks, 3 months, and 6 months. And not just for litigation. Maybe you don't even know that you had it. And if we don't check 6 weeks when it's positive, you might think, oh, this patient gave me hep C. And of course, if the patient is hep C negative, then chances are you won't get it anyway. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you very much. You were a wonderful audience, and